Those who are able, please remain standing for the reading of our gospel lesson this morning. We're reading from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 4, verses 12 through 23. Now when Jesus heard that John had been arrested, he withdrew to Galilee.
He left Nazareth and made his home in Capernaum by the sea, in the territory of Zebulun and Naphtali, so that what had been spoken through the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. Land of Zebulun, land of Naphtali, on the road by the sea across the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles, the people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. And for those who sat in the region of the shadow of death, light has dawned. From that time, Jesus began to proclaim, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." As he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who's called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." Immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went from there, he saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, in the boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets. And he called them. Immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and curing every disease and every sickness among the people. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Amen. Please be seated. Before I get started preaching, I have to say how good it is to have Pastor Deborah back. I'm really overjoyed, probably the most of the rest of you, that she's back up here this morning. I will say that I feel a little bit lazy this morning for how much sitting I have done over on the other side of the pulpit area, but that's an okay thing. It's a good feeling. It's a good feeling. This morning, I want us to talk a little bit about our passage from 1 Corinthians that Pastor Deborah read just a little bit ago. And I want us to talk about it for a lot of reasons, but one of the main reasons is that anytime we have an opportunity to read and look at and hear from Paul's letter to the Corinthians, his letters to the Corinthians, I feel like we should take notice, because the Corinthians, more than any other of the churches that Paul started, that group of people, that culture that they lived in, is closest to ours. They share a lot of things in common with us, even today, despite the fact that they lived in first century Corinth. There's a lot of stuff that makes them kind of like us. For instance, Corinth was kind of a double port city. They sat on this peninsula, really, and an isthmus, if you will, and on either side of the city, they butted up to seas, and so they could receive ships from either side, which meant they had a lot of people in their community, a melting pot. They had lots of different cultures, lots of different beliefs. They had lots of different ideas floating around in the city. They had all sorts of different stuff going on in their city. And so a lot of the things that they run up against and the traps that they fall into, we still fall into, because we live in the same kind of place in the same kind of time in our country, in our communities. They're getting more diverse. We have more people who aren't like us, different ideas, different cultures all the time, growing that way all the time. And so I want us to turn our attention to the Corinthian church and this passage in particular this morning because of what Paul commends them to do. We don't think this was Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. He had to write four letters, we think, and we have two of them saved for us. And that tells us that the Corinthians had some issues, because Paul didn't, he wrote lots of letters, but more than likely he wrote one and they listened, and then they reformed and he didn't have to write another one. For the Corinthians, that's not the case. They were a little hard-headed. So he's writing to the Corinthians. It's probably his second letter to them. And in it, in this first chapter, as we've chaptered it out, this first chapter, one of the things he commends them to do is to find unity with one another, to find a way to be united with one another. And so I want us to turn and look at this, because unity is kind of a peculiar thing. It's a strange thing. Unity is fragile. It's part of its peculiarity. It's a fragile thing and prone to corruption and misunderstanding. We don't always get it. We don't understand what it really means to be united in something, in anything, a lot of times. We'll talk about that in a minute, but unfortunately for us sitting here today, we probably need to understand unity more than most. More than most. As people who have chosen to gather in a united Methodist church, our presence here, whether you knew it or not, makes some claims about the importance of unity to our understanding of faith, of our spiritual life. United is in our name, for goodness sake. And given the fact that we live in the United States at a time when our country is very divided, it might just be good for us to understand and practice unity as a church so that our community, country, and world can see what it means. Now, while it may be unfortunate for us that we need to understand unity more than most, the fortunate part is that unity is an important theme in Scripture, particularly in the New Testament. We didn't read it this morning, but in John's Gospel, Jesus instructs us to be united in Him as disciples. It's part of His major instructions to His disciples before He's arrested and crucified, to be united in Him. And in our passage from Paul's letter to the Corinthians, this first letter, we hear that same message. Be united in Christ. As we've said, the Corinthians had a problem, several of them, but the biggest one, the one that Paul identifies first, is that they had begun to focus on, argue over, and be divided by their differences. And the difference that Paul lifts up in this passage, his first difference that he lifts up, this primary one, is that the Corinthians were arguing over who was baptized by whom. Some were baptized by Paul, others by Apollos, some by Cephas. They claimed this baptism by these apostles, by these folks who were spreading the good news of the gospel, they claimed that as their reason for being right, as their reason for being the better Christians, for knowing more, for having a better story of coming to faith. They made it a claim on who was right and who was wrong in the church in Corinth. And while this is the first and kind of primary difference and division among the Corinthians, it's later revealed in this letter that they've also divided themselves by class and wealth, as well as by their cultural and ethnic backgrounds, and by their understandings of the gospel and the freedom that some felt through the gospel, where others wanted to remain more strict in their adherence to Jewish law and culture. It's at this point that some of this may sound and feel a little familiar, as we still divide ourselves along a lot of these lines. We'll claim, you know, that we were brought to faith by a particular pastor or evangelist or a particular kind of story or moment in our faith life and lift it up as a way that our story is better than someone else's finding Jesus. We'll highlight our differences and divide ourselves by class and wealth as well as by our cultural and ethnic backgrounds. And yes, we still divide ourselves by our understandings of the gospel. We're still a lot like the Corinthian church. And so Paul lifts up this difference. He names it. He says, I hear some of y'all are doing this. I hear that you're practicing this kind of division. I hear that you're practicing this kind of spiritual malaise. And he advises them. He doesn't just lift it up and name it and say, figure this out. He says, agree with each other. Agree with each other. And don't be divided into rival groups. Agree with each other and don't be divided into rival groups. And then he goes on to explain that that means to be restored with the same mind and same purpose within the church. This is the essence of unity. Having the same mind, the same purpose. Agreeing on our purpose, and that our purpose is strong enough to hold us together despite our many other differences. That's what it means to be united. It doesn't mean that we're not different. Hear me on that. Being united, having unity, doesn't mean that we're not different. It doesn't mean that we don't have differing opinions about the best way to live into our purpose or about the details needed to execute our purpose. It doesn't mean that we're not different in so many ways. Instead, it means that we recognize that our purpose unites us amid our differences, despite our differences, because of our differences. It's our purpose that unites us. In fact, if we had no differences, if this group had no differences among us, and we all were acting in the same way, according to the same will, with the same purpose, even, we still wouldn't be united. I'll tell you why. Because if we had no differences, we would be uniform. We would have uniformity. But that's not unity. Being the same is not the same as being united, bound together. Because where uniformity reigns, unity cannot exist. This is a major theme of a study by Kathy Escobar and Carl Wheeler, Different But Not Divided, Practicing the Third Way, that we did as a small group study last year. And the idea here is that uniformity as a goal, if you will, an unworthy goal, I would argue, requires division. Uniformity requires us to divide ourselves. It's the only way it can be maintained. It leads to isolation. Because ultimately, when we are committed to uniformity over unity, we look for differences so that we can eliminate them from our midst. We identify the people who think differently, who act differently, who look differently, and we make sure either they don't come back or we don't. So that we'll all be the same, peaceful. Not really peace. But as people called to unity, to be united, we are called to be united. As those people who are called to be united, we acknowledge our differences in order to learn to be united more fully through the power of the Holy Spirit and in our common purpose. Notice that we still acknowledge our differences. We don't ignore them. Ignoring them is not an option. Ignoring them is just another way to maintain uniformity. It's a way to pretend there are no differences among us so we don't have to talk about it, so we don't have to deal with it, so we don't have to look ourselves in the mirror as a church, as a community, as a country, and acknowledge the differences among us and learn to live with it. It's a false sense of security and safety just to ignore the differences among us. We're called to acknowledge our differences in order to be united more fully through the power of the Holy Spirit, because what we acknowledge is that left to our own devices in our sinful and broken nature, we will always seek uniformity. By our own power, that's the best we can do, is to find uniformity, to find the people we agree with most, to find our echo chamber, and just to live there, comfortable, hearing people tell us that we're right and telling people they're right for thinking the same thing we do. And if somebody pipes up with a differing opinion, we ostracize them, and so then there's one less. That's how we get to that isolation piece. Because you just keep splitting and keep dividing until there's nobody left but you. And you know you can agree with you. At least most of us can. But we are called to find unity through the power of the Holy Spirit, to rely on Christ to bind us together despite any differences we may have, to bind us together despite our differences of political orientation, our political parties that we vote for, our ideologies that we hold to, our economic ideologies that we have, to hold us together despite even those differences in this day and age. Somebody at Contemporary said, I thought you were talking about Carolina and Clemson football. And I am. It's even that difference that Christ binds us together. Despite. We're bound together despite all the things that would divide us, despite all the things that the world says, you know what? You should just divide yourselves from those people you don't think like, from those people you don't want to be with, from those people that have this opposing viewpoint from you. Just hang out with the ones that think and act and believe like you do. That doesn't come from God. That idea does not come from God. To be uniform does not come from God. Being united amidst our diversity, amidst our difference, that comes from God. That is God's chosen way for us as human beings, and it's God's chosen way for the church to model what it means to be disciples of Jesus Christ, to live with our differences. Let me tell you, I hear all the time from people who have different opinions about how the church should be. Just in case you think this only applies to the culture, this applies to the church. We have all sorts of people in this church that have all sorts of differing opinions about how the church should be, what kind of ministries we should have, what kind of missions we should have, what the budget should look like, how we should do this, how we should do that. All sorts of people have all sorts of opinions in this church. I know y'all can't believe that, but it's true. Everybody's got an idea about how this should go because everybody has a particular call, something they're called to do, some way they're called to be in mission and ministry in the kingdom of God as disciples. Everybody's got a piece of this puzzle to fit together. And the goal is not just to create a church where we have one kind of disciple who believes one kind of way about how church is and one kind of way about how things should be done. That's not the goal as a church. The goal for us as a church is to pull in the same direction, to identify what our common purpose is, and to let everybody pull in that direction with the strengths and gifts and talents and passions that they have. So we're pulling in the direction of making disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world, to make sure people know about this Master and Savior that we know, to make sure that people know about this Jesus Christ who lived with us, died for us, and was raised for our sake, to make sure that people know about the Holy Spirit present in our life, to make sure that they know that that's out there and that they see it in our actions in the ways that some of us choose to use our gifts to care for one another, and the ways others of us use our gifts to proclaim this message, and the ways others of us use our gifts to teach and to do mission work. All of us do all of that, pulling in the same purpose, in the same direction, in the same way, to make disciples of Jesus Christ, not just for our own benefit, not just for Jesus' benefit, but to transform the world, to show the world it is possible for a diverse and different-minded group of people to pull in the same direction with the same purpose so that the world might be a better place. That's who we are. That's what we're called to be. That's what we're called to witness to the world with. To make sure that everybody knows that we're different from one another. That you and I think differently about things. You don't agree with me on everything, and I don't agree with you on everything. But we're still here together, caring for one another, loving one another, and pulling in the same direction, the same purpose, to make disciples of Jesus Christ, because that is the most important thing. Because this faith and this hope, this grace that we know is the most important thing, and it's more important than any of the things that keep us apart. any of the things that separate us, any of the things that make us want to flee to our little uniform enclave echo chambers where we can feel safe and secure and right. That's what we're looking for. Now, this will be my last piece on this before we finish, but this is my disclaimer. Sometimes, when we have a message like this, our tendency as disciples, as human beings, is to go out into the world and say, you know what? I know 14 people that really needed to hear this message because they don't think like I do, and I need to make sure that they heard that they need to agree with me. It happens by accident. It happens subtly, but I'm going to name it right now. Don't do that. Don't do it. Okay? This message is meant for you and for me to work on ourselves, to hear that rather than going out and telling everybody they're wrong and they need to think like us so that they can be united with us, it's not unity, that's uniformity, folks. Rather than saying that, that when you get home, when you wake up, when you go to God in prayer, when you look in the scriptures, you think about, what is it that I can do today? What are the things that I can do today in my life to make sure that I'm an agent of unity in the world? To make sure that I'm a person who is working so that the world might be united in a common purpose in the church, in our communities. What is it that I can do to make sure that I'm lifting up the things that we have in common, our common purpose, our common work, our common life together? What are the things I can do to lift up those things that bind us together rather than lifting up the things that divide us and keep us apart? What is it that I can do to make sure unity reigns and uniformity disappears from the face of this earth? That's the point of this message. End of my public service announcement. We've been called into the church, the diverse, beautiful body of Christ, where everybody has a role, everybody has a function, everybody is gifted and graced by the power of the Holy Spirit to do something specific and different, to fit into the body and to pull in the same direction with Christ our head, to make more disciples, to transform the world into the kingdom of God so that all might know and all might see the grace and the love and the beauty that God intends for us. That's my hope for you in the next days and weeks and years of your life. It's my hope for us as a church as we move forward together, the same purpose, all pulling with different gifts, diverse skill sets, the myriad of experiences and viewpoints and opinions. That is the hope that we have as the people of God. Would you go to God in prayer with me now? Heavenly and Almighty God, you bind us together. Through the power of your Holy Spirit, you hold us with one another. You hold us with you, making sure we can't run away and flee from the grace, from the love, from the compassion that you would share. Making sure that we don't deny it to others. Hold us tight this day. Hold us tight in the days to come. Bind us up over and over again with one another so that we might move forward. Power and presence that only you can give, so that we might be a witness to the world of what it means to truly be united, to live into our differences, and to work together, using them because of them. Help us to be the people that you call us to be, to hear the call that you've placed on each and every heart this day, so that we might know the ways you've empowered us to be a part of this movement. Give us the courage and the boldness to take that first step into mission and ministry in your name. We ask these things in the name of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, who came and lived among us, despite the fact that he was so different from us, chose to be united with us in our flesh, to become one of us, to die our death, and to be raised for our sakes, so that we might be united to you now and forevermore. Amen. Our hymn of sending.